Thank you. Also, thanks for having me for the first ever WordCamp Nordic. It's an honor to speak today in front of so many people. I'm really surprised. Thank you for coming. Even if it's that early, at least for me, I'm not really that morning guy, but yeah. Today, I would like to talk a little bit about my favorite topic in WordPress, because it's one of my topics, because I'm from Germany, and so my native language isn't English, which is actually the main language of WordPress, the WordPress project. And yeah, so I would like to talk a little bit about this topic today. I'm Dominik Schilling. I'm a WordPress core developer since 6 years, and also heavily involved in the translation projects, which is not really new, as you will see a little bit later. And because of this, I have a little subtitle for today's talk, which is a history of 7.7 million minutes in 30 minutes. So yeah, let's check if we can do this today. Just a little note, because my topic is actually the state of WordPress internationalization in 2019, because this word is not really that easy to pronounce. There's a short form which is called IATN. So please excuse if I continue to use the IATN short form for the next few slides. So just to let you know that this is just a short form of internationalization. So that was the last one. So because, or let's say, why are there so many minutes since the first slide which I mentioned there? Because the first talk, the first mention of IATN was in a blog post on WordPress.org/news, which was at April 2004. And that was really the first mention of IATN and also localization 10N. And maybe you know which version was released in 2004? Any idea? Come on.
1.3.
No?
1.3.
No? But close?
1.2.
Yes. It was 1.2. And this was the first ever release which got the first localization of WordPress and Unicode support. So that's why I have chosen the subtitle with 7.7 million minutes, which is actually so the date, the time frame between 2004 and today. And yeah, I choose the first two slides because every time I'm talking about IATN or translation, it's really surprising that I still have to, or that we still have to educate some developers to let them know that there is another language than English. So since 2004, the base API or the localization support was there, but a lot of has changed to make this process of translating and to make your plugin theme and even core much easier to translatable, and also for translators, because there was at this time no really good platform to support, I don't know, like many more languages which we today have. So let's start at the beginning. You may download a WordPress.zip file, and once you open it, you see a lot of PHP files. And if you open one of them, maybe you see that there's everything in English. So if you have installed your WordPress the first time, you see everything in English, maybe. But as we all know, there isn't only English. So let's take a look at the word dashboard, which you see here or here. And in this slide, you can see all the translations which we are currently having for the word dashboard. So maybe you see also the translation in your language. And the question is now, how do we put all these translations of the Swing dashboard back to WordPress? Or actually, how do we make WordPress ready to make this Swing dashboard translatable? The first part is the so-called getText functions. It's a PHP library, but in WordPress we actually have our own library on top of, actually not on top of getText, but it's a similar API who provides a framework to be able to make strings like dashboard translatable. In this case, it's the underscore underscore function, which simply expects the string. And these functions are also wrapped in a framework which is called POMO. PO and MO are two file types, which we will see a little bit later on how they are looking and what you can do with them. And now we have the string in the PHP file, but we still can't translate them, because you don't want to change any core files. For example, you wouldn't really add your translation into this file. And there was a tool which was called MakePod.php. It's a 10-year-old script which was also developed at the time of probably 2004, which simply extracts all the translatable strings from core into a file named pod. This file is no longer in use. But we have a super awesome alternative now, which is part of the official project called WP CLI. Some of you may know him. It's a CLI interface for your WordPress, which you can install on your server, and then you can type into the your terminal some play a little bit of hacker to get all your data or create posts and so on. And since version 2.0, we also have the new command iatn makepod, which is the replacement of the previous makepod PHP file. And it does the same as the script, just better. Because there were some bugs and also some compatibility issues with PHP versions. And it also extracts all the strings from core, also our special syntax for translator comments. So if a string isn't really clear enough, you can add a comment to the string. And this makepod command also extracts the translator comments. And makepod, because pod is actually a file type, and which looks like this. It's a simple text file which has the reference to the string. In this case, it's wp-admin-index.php, line 31. You have the message ID, which is the English original string, and the message string is, in this case, empty, because it's a template. As you can see, it's a portable object template, which you can use to create other files. This one is a simple example for a singular string, but we also have, for example, the string comments, which is actually based on the number of comments. So we have the, actually, I have made a typo here. It's not with the S, just comment, and the plural is comments. And also we have, in this case, two matches strings, 0 and 1, depending on the plural form of the language. So now we have the pod file, which is the simple text file, which you can translate. For example, maybe you have heard of PoEdit or TransiFX, which is an online service. But today I'm talking about GlotPress. GlotPress is a WordPress plugin which you can use to create your own collaboration and web-based software translation tool. it's really old, just like WordPress. It was, I think the first commit was done in 2009. And it's also an official sister project of WordPress, just like BBPress or BuddyPress. And at this time, there was also a library called BackPress, which was kind of deprecated. It was more or less a library of WordPress. But we took the opportunity to make it a WordPress plugin just like BBPress and BuddyPress in 2016. So you actually can install your own CloudPress, because it's a simple plugin which you can install on every WordPress site. So the development happens on GitHub. So if you are interested to be one of our contributors, you're always looking for more, because we have a lot of ideas, but just actually, I don't know, two or three developers. And so if you are interested, please join us at GitHub to help make CloudPress a little bit more better. But now, I don't want you to install all your own CloudPress install, because we have one huge install for WordPress.org, which you will find on translate.webpress.org. It's maintained by the official WordPress meta team, and we use it to give really translators a central platform to submit their translation for core themes, plugins, or also our web apps and also some meta projects, or even WordCamp sites. And really, everyone with a WordPress.org account can submit their translation. In this case, it's a simple example where you can see what you can translate everything: WordPress themes, plugins, meta, and the app. And in this case, you can also translate, I think, since 4.1 is actually, I think, the first version which you can translate on translate.wordpress.org. And the port file just gets imported into this platform, so you don't have to do this. It's done on a cron job which runs every hour, which simply imports a text file with the default CloudPress CD importer. And if you are on Slack, you will find a few Slack notifications in the Polyglot channel which are looking like this. For example, if there's a new string, you get the information and can jump into translate.webs.org and translate the string. Let's get back to our dashboard string. In this case, it's the finished version of the translation project. Here you can see the original dashboard string. You can also see the references here, and this one is the translation. In this case, maybe it's important to know that everyone can submit translations, but they are not directly approved, because we have some special rules in the Polyglots team. In this case, we have the translators and also the editors, and the editors validate your submission, and if they are, or if the translation is good enough, they approve your translation, or if not, they can reject, and and you can provide a better translation. Now we have the translation, we have the port file, but how do we get them back to WordPress? In this case, we have something called language packs, which is a thing since, I don't know, 4.0, I think. And it exports every translation which you have previously submitted in a zip file. It's updated every 12 to 24 hours, and it contains these files. We have 6 to 8 files, depends on the language. For example, all the English variants, they don't have the continent and cities file, because it's more or less the same. They don't really provide a translation for city names. And for performance reasons, we have split all the translation into 4 projects. The normal one is for all the front end strings, admin for the admin strings. Then we also have for multi-site, the admin network part, and of course continent cities, which is only used for the settings to set your time zone. The PO file is actually a text file again, which is called portable object, so no template anymore. We finally have our message string for the dashboard string. We also have some metadata. In this case, it's the file for Spanish and the Spanish translation of dashboard. So this file you can actually read, but WordPress doesn't read this file. It reads, of course, a file which is like this, with a lot of numbers. It's the MO file, which is called a machine object. And this one is bytecode and also used by all the getText functions. To get the language packs actually to WordPress back, we have the WordPress Translation API, which is an official API of WordPress.org, which just requests, depending on your language set in WordPress, all the plugins, themes, and core, and it returns you all the language packs. For example, the response looks a little bit like this. You have the package URL to the zip file, also the version of the file, and the date, and of course the language. And if you download a newer WordPress zip file, you probably don't even start with English, because since 4.0, we have this awesome language chooser, which allows you, during the installation, to select your language already. So instead of first installing your WordPress into English, you can directly select your language, and you are ready to go to use WordPress in your language. So language packs are really the best thing, I think, in the last 4 years which happened to WordPress, because they are so easy, so automated, that you don't really have to worry about languages anymore. The languages are stored in the wcontent languages directory. They are automatically updated. They are installed on the fly. For example, if you switch a language, or even if you install a new plugin, theme, and so on, they are installed right in the background. You don't have to worry about it. And by doing other updates, for example, if you update a plugin, I don't know, Hello Dolly, and there's an update for another plugin, you also get the languages, the translations of other plugins. So in this case, you also don't have to worry about this. This is also one of the reasons why you should really never ever disable auto updates. Now we have the files back on our WordPress install. There's now a thing called Core Translation API, which is for core, this function load default text domain, which, depending on your admin screen, loads either only the front end strings, or the admin strings, or the admin network strings. And if you go even further, we are back to our getText functions. This underscore underscore function now searches for the string in the previous loaded translations to load default text domain, and we finally get back to the translation of dashboard in our UI. Oh, I did this much something, I think. What could it be? Yeah, well, we have 2019, and in the end of 2018, there was something new to WordPress. And of course, it was the blog editor and JavaScript. And yeah, JavaScript is not PHP. You can't really use all the PHP functionality which we had for the last decade So we had to find something new. And luckily, the Gutenberg team came up with an API, which is similar to the GetText API, which is part of the WPIATN namespace. It's also a JavaScript package, which you can download. So you can even use it without WordPress. And for example, if you open the, there's a component called .tip, which has the string. And as you can see, it's the same as the underscore underscore dashboard string in PHP. Just in this case, it's a short form, or actually it's WPIATN dot underscore underscore, or if you import, depending on your JavaScript skills and what do you want to have, you can import it like this, or you reference it like this. And the good thing, we only had to change the API to make strings translatable. So we have a new API, wp.iatn, but for extracting the strings, we still can rely on wp-cli, because it even parses JavaScript files, and that was also one of the reasons why we had to change the script parser. And let's get back to language packs. I actually lied, because there are 11 more files. In this case, we have JSON files. There are 11 files because there are actually 11 components which you can translate, and each component has its own translation file. And in case you are worrying or wondering what this hash is, it's just the MD5 string of the path of the script. And it's, of course, a text file in the jet1.x format, which looks like this. It's simply JSON with our translations and strings. And actually, we had one more thing to change. We also have the WP set script translation function, which lets WordPress know to load the JSON file for your script. You just have to pass the script handle. So if you do WP underscore register script, for example, you also have to add the temp dependency WP IATN, and finally also WP set script translation to register the handle and also the text domain, actually, not script, right? Yeah. So this was mostly about core. So the question might be if language packs are also a thing for plugins and themes. And the answer is, of course, yes. There are just a few requirements to make this working properly. The first one is that you have a proper text domain registration. But there's a special case if you are supporting only 4.6 and up, because in this case, you only have to do this part. You don't have to call load plugin or load theme text domain. You don't have to define text domain, domain path, and so on. Just say that your plugin at least requires 4.6, or even better, do it 5.1. And of course, the plugin must be hosted in the official WordPress directory. That's all what you have to do to make translations work via translate.wordpress.org, and also to get the automated language packs. If you want to know a little bit more about this, you can check out the handbook. There are also another Slack channel, which is called Meta Language Packs, which you can follow to get a little bit input about your plugin. For example, if it's not compatible, you get a message and can fix your plugin or theme. And if you want to know more about language packs, you can even see what languages are available for your plugin or theme. So what about private projects? Because, as you have heard before, the requirement is that you are hosting your plugin and theme in the official plugin directory or scene directory. But since I'm working for a Swiss-based company, we are also dealing a lot with translations. And to improve our internal workflow, which means reducing repetitive tasks or even stop sending any Excel files between the customer and us, we have introduced something called Traduttore. It's basically like this. We have for public plugins and themes which are in the directory, the WordPress.org translation API. For our client projects, we have the Traduttore setup, which allows our customer to directly translate the strings. And both APIs just give back a language pack fully automated to each website which is using the plugin or theme. So it basically allows you to set up your own translate.webpress.org. And the good thing, everything, even our tools, is open source. So you only need WordPress, you only need Blockpress, you need WP CLI and Traduttore, and also Traduttore registry to allow WordPress to download the zip file. As mentioned before, everything runs automatically. It has a direct integration with GitHub via webhooks. We're also working on GitLab and Bitbucket. It uses WP CLI to import the strings, generates the zip files, and has a direct integration into the WordPress translation API with all the benefits which I have mentioned before. So in case you want to have your own install, looks, for example, this is our platform, which we also have a little bit customized. And as you see, it's the same API as from WordPress.org. And if you're interested, you can see the project on GitHub. I want to quickly talk about some more features. First one is user locals, which is a thing since 4.7. It basically allows you to set for each user your own locale. And so that means that your site no longer has only one language or one local. Every user can have their own language and local. For this, we also have the locale switching, which allows you, for example, if you are sending a notification to many users, you can switch to the language of the user and send the notification in their language. So it's similar to if you know a multi-site switch to block, you can also switch to local. And also an interesting project is called Preferred Languages, which is not yet part of Core. It's a feature project to allow the user to select a stack of languages. For example, for our clients, we also always have this kind of stack. For example, we first use the Swiss German language. If a plugin has no translation in Swiss German, we are falling back to the formal version of German. And if this one even doesn't exist, we fall back to German. So if you are interested, it's also an open source plugin which quite ready, or even for the new JavaScript translation API. So if you want to have fallbacks for your languages, I highly recommend this plugin. So let's quickly go through some stats, as I usually do in my slides, even if I have time over. So at the moment, we have 168 locals. Our team has 2,500 editors and 74,000 translators, which translates 140 projects, which means core, meta, plugin, theme, and so on. This is a little bit about 2010, where we only had 223,000 swings. in this case, in 2000, between 2040 and 15, we allowed plugins and themes to use our platform. And so at the moment, we have nearly 47 million translations, which is a huge database, which we want to use much more, for example, for, I don't know, translation memory and so on. We have a lot of language packs with a lot of downloads. And this also helped us to have actually reached 24.7%, which are not using the English-American local as default. The future, we want to improve, of course, translate.wordpress.org, for example, with an improved editor UI, also translation memory, or copy from other languages, or even rejecting with feedback, or actually giving feedback to a string. And for this, we are trying to have a new editor UI. In this case, you are the first one to see this, which kind of looks like this. And here you can even see we have some sort of translation memory. This is also planned for the next few weeks. Language packs, we want to make them faster. We want to make them less complex. And for core, of course, performance improvements every time a topic. But you also may have heard of Gutenberg Phase 4, which should introduce an official way to support multilingual sites. So that's something which has Matt mentioned in his last State of Word. So that was it. Sorry for a little bit more, but yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Dominic. Yeah, I'm sure a lot of us have used a localized version of WordPress, but it's easy to forget how much thought and work goes behind it, so thank you. Thank you for presenting that to us. So right now we have still a bit of time left for, for questions. So if you have a question, please raise your hand and we'll get a microphone for you. Okay, over there.
Yeah, the mic runner is really slow.
Hi, my name's Daniel. I'm a long-time PTE for the Finnish translation. I was very interested in the new features you just very briefly showed us. So I was wondering if you could perhaps just go back a few slides and give us a very short introduction of how the translation memory will work and how giving feedback.
I mean,
will work.
It's kind of a little bit secret project, so
okay.
I just want to tease it a little bit. But of course, I actually don't have a screen of the actual UI. But for example, in GlotPress, you also have a new feature, which it's called notes or comments. And our current UI doesn't really allow to add more items. So the first step is to redesign the editor which we have. And in this case, that's the current version of the translation memory, which is actually using, or it's done with the help of WordPress.com, which have their own translation memory, which we will be able to use also for .org. And it just checks the source string, looks for any related translations, and in this case, not true. But in this case, you have 100%, which is a direct match, or there's even a similar string, or a similar original string. In this case, it's 87%. And if you think it's a good enough translation for this string, you just can click copy this, and it will insert it into the, or it will be used as a translation.
Is a memory, is it like per project or per locale?
I'm not really sure. I think it's per local. So it's really used every project. And yeah.
So if someone's translated something in Finnish in core and then someone's translating like WooCommerce.
Right, yeah. So it will use the same.
That.
Yes.
Yeah. Cool.
Okay, thank you. Yep. There's a question.
I'm just wondering about the cost of uploading translations in WordPress, and if there's some way you can cache that or something like that. If you're running, for example, a large site with lots of plugins and stuff, what the sort of overhead is of loading a locale, which is not the default, and if there's some way to make it faster.
So the question is about the performance of loading the translation. Okay. Yeah, there is quite an overhead, which is mostly caused by not using the native GetEx API, because we have our own wrapper and our own function. So there is indeed small, I would say, performance decrease. But we're also working on making this faster, for example, by lazy loading the translation. There's also a ticket with the patch, which we probably have to take another look at. So we are really trying to make this as performant as possible. But there are also plugins who try to cache the translation, for example, in the object cache or in the database even, which I wouldn't really recommend. But yeah, so I hope that answers your question.
Is it enough of an issue to warrant something, like, is it something that you feel should be an issue for Core to address, for example?
I mean, it is an issue, yes, of course. I mean, we have the tickets, we are working on making it better, so, yeah. But it's not that really that you would say it's that bad to have another local than English.
Thanks.
We have there and there.
Yeah, we have a few questions here, I guess. Yep, over there.
Is there coordination between translation and themes team in order, for example, to give support to language like Hebrew who are written right to left?
I'm not sure I get the question.
Because for themes is important, the things like text lengths and so on. Is there any coordination or test practice so I can trust that every theme that WordPress provides, like 2019 or 2018, works with right to left languages?
I can say that officially default themes, of course, they support right to left languages. I'm not really sure if there's any requirement to have right to left. I'm not really sure. I'm not really into the theme review theme, so maybe no, you know, no. Okay. So if somebody know if there's a requirement to have right to left support for your themes, anyone? No. So I would suggest to really ask the team directly on Slack or so, or I can look it up and tell you later. Okay.
Okay. I think we have time for one more question. I think there was at least one over there.
Hello. I wonder how I can have a dashboard in one language and front-end in another one. By default, not to set up another language to the person.
You can, actually, because it's the same functionality I have mentioned, switch to local, which you can use, for example, for this. But the user language is only used for the admin. So the site, the language of the front end is still the same which you have selected in the site. So if a user selected, for example, German, but your site is set to Spanish, the front end is still in Spanish, not in German.
So it will be not for front end users.
It's right. It's only for the admin, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Welcome. Okay.
Okay, I think we're out of time for questions. I know some of you still had some, but maybe you can go look Dominic up during
the
break.
Yeah,
so
the whole day,
he'll maybe be here. So let's give one more time applause for Dominic.
Thank you.
So next up, we already have our first break. And if you, when you signed up, you said that you'd like a scarf. They're now giving out those scarves or the swag stuff in the main lobby where you did the registration. So go ahead and get your swag. And the program will be back at 20 past 10.